Robert, a lot has happened over the past couple of days. What was your reaction when you first heard the news?
I mean, for us, it's we've known about it. I mean, the rumors were out there, and the big thing was just, oh, it's really the CIA. Oh, even worse, it's the BND is part of it too. So that was quite a surprise that the BND was also part of it.
As a company that's in the business of actually producing hardware to secure communications, are you seeing this more as a risk or as an opportunity?
I mean, it's not good, you know, for Switzerland and for the industry here providing cybersecurity and so on, because it gives a bad light on us. But on the other hand, it's really, I mean, a crisis is also an opportunity. So that's why I'm here. That's why I can tell our story and say what we do actually to make sure that the transparency is there, that the customers can trust what we are doing and trust our equipment.
Talk to us more about that. How can you turn this into an opportunity, in fact? Because in some ways, the business model does overlap with what CryptoAge was doing.
Yeah, I mean, it's like they did cryptography and now we do cryptography. They're in Switzerland, we're in Switzerland, so it's all the same, you know. So, you know, we started the company 6 years ago and we were aware of that 6 years ago, and we tried to be clearly different than a CryptoAge. We also decided we are clear about our ownership, you know. We're a Swiss-owned business, you know. My co-founder, Andreas Kuriger, and I own still most of the company. We have a small group of Swiss investors, and our employees are also owners of the company, like a startup.
Yes. And even the naming in that regard, there was also a lot of consideration on how to position yourself.
Yeah, that was a little thing we talked about. You know, we didn't like, we're here in Zurich, but our name is Securosys SA, because we didn't want to have an AG and the association with the crypto AG in our name. So even that, we thought about that, yeah.
I noticed on your website, just very interestingly enough, you've made it clear there are no back doors, okay? And I understand that this has actually been there for a while now, not just in response to the latest events. How are you planning to ease potential concerns from outsiders? Are there plans to maybe even distance yourself even more further?
There's a clear difference what we do. So. And as you say, the statement that we have no backdoors has been there, I think, from the start, you know, because that is something you have to stand behind and as a company also ensure that everything is done, that there are no backdoors in our equipment. So this goes into letting the customers in, you know, and review everything, but it also has to is the same thing with the people we employ, making sure that the people are trustworthy, you know, how we produce the software. You know, we build boxes, but in the end, it's a lot of software in these boxes that is protected by this box. Maybe I make sure that this software is secure, that nobody can put stuff into our software. You know, it goes on to when we produce the boxes, you know, and they come to us and we load the software, we're actually having a mechanism that once the software is in there, we have a battery in there and the box is live, active, without power, without AC power, and it protects itself. So it makes sure that nobody can manipulate it, nobody can tamper it.
All the latest developments have brought into question this idea of Swiss neutrality. Not only that, but also the concept of Swiss reliability. How do you see this potentially playing a factor going forward?
Yeah, I think every company has to deal with that by themselves. What we're doing is really we stay open, you know. I mean, when I say transparency, you know, it's not like we're putting everything out and make everything open source. No, but we invite our customers to come to us and review everything. So they can review our offices, they can review the blueprints, they can review the source code and can verify that what we're selling to them is free of backdoors. And some companies actually came and did that, yeah.
So talk to me about your client base right now. Where do we see the majority of this? And are you actually also working with governments at this point?
So the majority of our clients are banks, really. It's in the finance industry. So we're we are actually protecting the old style finance. You know, the Swiss interbank clearing is a part of what we're doing, what we're protecting. But we're also in the new finance, which is the which I call blockchain. You know, tokenized assets, protecting tokenized assets. But we're also selling to governments. You know, if a government decides our equipment is very good and they can use it in to protect their infrastructure, which they should do, you know, then we sell to governments. Yeah.
Do we see potentially a closer relationship with the Swiss government between Securosys going forward?
I'm happy to sell equipment to the Swiss government. You know, it's like we're a business. We're in the business of making money. You know, and of course, if they can use our equipment, we're happy to provide it.
How profitable would you say this overall business is, especially in Switzerland? And how do you see the development of the market?
Yeah, so Switzerland is really a small market, you know, to be honest. You know, and that's why we're actually focusing going international and growing worldwide. I mean, we started already, we have a subsidiary in Germany, we have a subsidiary in Hong Kong. And the worldwide market, you know, for it's when I'm talking about the boxes that secure those keys that are used in the transactions, in the banking systems, this is maybe $500 million US dollars. But it's growing very strongly because the new businesses that come up, the blockchain business. I mean, you have a lot of guests talking about blockchain, and we're actually protecting quite a few companies there that provide custodian services.
And as this continues to grow, do you plan to expand into other markets? What could those potentially be?
Oh, we want to sell our equipment everywhere in the world. We have the best product. So we're in Hong Kong. I think Singapore is the next one. The Middle East, we're visiting there quite often. Britain, as London is a very strong financial place. And of course, we're going to go to the US. You know, we have customer interest from the US for our equipment.
Okay, so to bring it all back home, you're looking at expansion, and for you, crypto AG is just history.
Yeah, I mean, it's really old news. I mean, honestly, it's... I mean, the thing with the CIA and the BND, you know, before it was just like... oh, there is a fund in Liechtenstein that owes them and nobody knows who it is. And now it's like, boom, CIA, BND. I mean, that's big news for me. So, but the rest of it, we knew about it.